My mother went to be with Jesus 22 years ago. That's a long time. And kids, I think of my mum, I reckon, at least once a week, and yet she's with Jesus. And when I reflect on that, I think it's because she impacted my life more than I think any other human being. And my dad impacted my life, but my mum had a very special place in my life. And I've just there's only one regret that I have with my mum is I never had the opportunity to actually take her away on my own just for a holiday. I did that with my dad. I took him on two world trips, 6 weeks at a time. I took him to Kakadu National Park. I took him to Alice Springs. We went all over the place. But my mum got sick soon after I got married. She had a severe stroke and she was paralysed on one side, and she lived another 14 years, but we couldn't take her away. But and I often say to people, and I had a leadership group last Tuesday night, and I said to them, if you're studying and learning how to minister, I think it really starts in your home. And I recommend that men and women take their mums out somewhere for a weekend or a week. While you have them, bless them. Now, I know sometimes there's situations where mums and dads are not worthy of that, and because of, you know, very small minority can be very abusive and it can be very difficult for kids. But most mums are beautiful and wonderful, and it's so easy for us to take them for granted. And I was thrilled just a few weeks ago. My wife Kathy had her 60th birthday, and she and her three daughters went to Melbourne for 3 days. I paid the airfares and the hotel, but I said, you spend your own money when it comes to buying clothes and goods. And I had a fabulous time. And I know my girls said it was just great and they want to do it again. And I just recommend that as a practice, girls, fellas, to do a special thing. If you can't take them away, write them a love letter of what you really think of them and put time and reflection into it, or a special gift, because they're not always going to be with us. And both my mum and dad are in the presence of Jesus, and I miss them still, yet I'm so thankful that my mum had such an impact on my life. Do you know the Apostle Paul, who was probably the greatest Christian leader ever outside of course, Jesus? There's a passage in Scripture where he actually says to us, if you want to know how to minister to people, and that means serving people, how to be good with people, how to help people, how to add value to people's lives, and for his own life, because we think of the Apostle Paul as the great leader, the strong man, and he was. But he actually said to us in a fantastic passage, he said, look at how mothers think and behave, and you will really understand what ministry is all about. Paul modeled his ministry by observing mothers in action. So let's read this passage, Paul's insight for words about his mothering ministry among the people of Thessalonica in northern Greece. He says, as apostles of Christ, we could have been a burden to you. And because they were there ministering. They were there, they'd come from Palestine and they were in northern Greece. They could have been a burden, financial burden, and in many respects. They had to find lodging and food and clothing and all that kind of stuff. But he said, but we were gentle among you, look at this, like a mother caring for her children. And he goes on describing this mothering ministry. We loved you so much that we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, like here's the gospel in writing or in word or speak, he said, but we shared our very lives with you. That's what mothers do. Surely you remember, brothers and sisters, our toil and hardship. That's what mums do. We work night and day in order not to be a burden on anyone while we preach the gospel of God to you. So I see from this passage, and just generally, you know, what do mothers do? You know what mothers do? They lift burdens. They calm us by their gentleness. They selflessly care for us. Mothers are so Christ-like by their selfless care, gentleness, and as burden lifters. And I love this passage from Matthew 11. And I think this is the feminine aspect of Christ coming out. Christ was a man. Okay, God has revealed himself in the masculine. But God is not male. He created male and female in Genesis 1. And so perfect femininity and perfect masculinity are in the very nature of God. And I can prove that to you because every girl here, every woman here, if I asked you, who would you really like to be like in character and nature? And you would say Jesus Christ. But he's a 33-year-old Palestinian Jew. But he's more than a man. You see in him the perfect feminine traits. And we see in him the perfect masculine traits. Because he loves humanity, and he made human beings, male and female, in his image. And I reckon this passage here in Matthew 11, you see the feminine aspect, the beautiful aspect of what a mother is like. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened. And what's he say? I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. I tell you, mums have an amazing capacity to understand and to help us in times of need. I remember when I was courting Kathy, and so I'm on my own, sort of, I became a Christian at 17, and for 4 years I was like, okay, I'm going to have no girlfriend, I'm going to wait till I'm 21 or so, 4 years, and at Bible college I met Kath and fell in love, and I thought, man, this is the best thing that's happened to me since I accepted Jesus, let's get married, and then she called it off. What a terrible thing she did to me. For 2.5 years we were separated. And I loved her dearly. And I tell you, even though I hated it, it was the best thing that could have happened for her and for me so that we could grow up a little bit more. But I remember I was in grief. You know, I was watching this film yesterday with Kathy called Far from the Madding Crowd by Tom Hardy. A modern version of it. And it's about a woman, and there's three men that fall in love with her. And she's the most beautiful, wonderful girl in her nature, and they just can't help but falling in love. And one guy, you know, he just is so nice, but she said, I like you, but it's not going to happen. And then he actually shares with the other guy, and he just starts weeping, and he says, I'm in such grief. Men are real crybabies when it comes to love. And so I know for myself, I was in grief. Who did I go to? To my entrepreneurial, strong, self-sufficient dad? He would say, suck it up and move on. Oh, I went to my dear mum, and I remember weeping and just in grief. And for just a period of time, she was able to encourage me so strongly. And like, she lifted the burden. She calmed me by her gentleness. She selflessly cared. And, you know, in those times, she was able to say some things. So, Billy, maybe you can learn something here. So she was able to teach me a little bit about what women are like. And she's asked me, how did you treat her? And how did I say this? And she would sow some seeds. And it was a growing up time. Mothers are like that. Her example was awesome. Mothers also generously share their lives with us, and they work tirelessly and sacrificially for us. And I remember another time with Mum in my late teens, just as I was coming to Christ, there was an economic difficulty, and Dad had property, and he was selling it, and he'd market garden, putting up units, and it was just very difficult at that particular time. And so Dad got a second job. So he worked in the railways in his mid-50s. And so he worked the gardens in the morning and got up at 4 a.m, picked all the tomatoes and cauliflowers. And then he'd go off to the work. And then Mum would actually, the whole day, sort them all out. After she would kind of do the food and prepare us for school. And I was in year 12. And then Dad would come home and he'd start the second shift, and they would be up to 10, 11 o'clock at night and then up again at 4. And I remember thinking, man, they're working like dogs. And I felt great, great sympathy for her. And I know that they were doing it for us, for me and my three sisters. And I just felt so unworthy. And when I became a Christian and Christ came to live in my life, I actually saw how selfish I was in relation to my mum. I saw myself as just a spoiled Greek brat who took his mother for granted, and she did everything. So I would just throw my clothes in the middle of the floor and mum would just pick them up and put them in there. And I mean, I was like a king in the home. Well, when I became a Christian, I saw how selfish I was and how selfless she was, how sacrificial she was and how I would take her for granted. So I started repenting, changing my mindset. And I remember a few times I cleaned the kitchen up. So as she's working, I'd go in, I'd mop the kitchen, do all the dishes, place looked fantastic, so clean you could eat off the floor. Mum would come in and go, Vasilaki, dikandis. She goes, Billy, what are you doing? Is there something wrong with you? Almost taking my temperature. I say, Mum, I just want to help you out. And so Greek mums spoil their boys. And I just saw how hard she worked. And my sisters and I talked after she had the stroke. We just wondered, you know, there was a few years later, and she was just younger than me. She was 61 and she had this terrible stroke. And in those 5 years beforehand, she just worked and worked and worked. And maybe that kind of precipitated some ill health. We don't know. But I know that impacted my life to see her selflessness, her tireless efforts on behalf of her children. And you know what? That, as we saw today, that reveals what God is like. I think we see in the beautiful nature of women, in the beautiful, beautiful heart of mothers, what God is really like. And so kids, as you see how good your mum is, that's what Jesus is like. He is like that. And I want to read a passage from you, another passage as I close. It's because Jesus was generous. He shared his life with us when he walked among us. And he revealed to us what God is really like as he walked among us. And then he died on a cross. He sacrificed his life on the cross to save us and to bring forgiveness for the many sins we committed between God and ourselves. And he kind of bridged the separation between a perfect God and sinful humanity. And our sins are all being forgiven when we come to Christ. He died on the cross to save us and to give us the gift of eternal life. And we didn't deserve it. In Romans 5, 6 to 8, it says this: you see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. He didn't die for good people. He died for the ungodly. I was ungodly. And I didn't deserve his new life. You know, mothers are like that. They just give and give and give and give and give. And they're so godlike. He says, very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, cut off from God in a helpless and hopeless state, Christ died for us. Jesus Christ is the greatest mother in all the world. He is the greatest father. He reveals to us what perfect mothering and perfect fathering is all about. And even if you've been a recipient of imperfect fathers and imperfect mothers, because no one has got it all together, we're all sinners saved by grace. You know, he becomes the model by which you can model your life to be an excellent dad, an excellent mum, an excellent father, an excellent husband, an excellent wife. And so Jesus among us and in us helps us and enables us in so way.